Okay, so let's get started. So far we looked at the technologies that have gone into making the modern processors that we are using and how exactly they have been incorporated into the modern processors. We had looked at that. Now let's look at the memory hierarchy design.
Sir, I have
one question. Yes, please.
Is there for integer, 14 by 16 bit.
Yes.
Why it is
so that
not,
is
why it is not in the power of
for the you are talking of the VLA, that's it. But why should a floating point, I mean what would be the advantage of a power up to? Let's see, his question is floating point registers are not a power up to. That is his observation. But no, that's okay, but let's try to address his question. I mean, why should it be a floating, why should be it be in a power up to register sizes? We have seen, we got used to it, 1632, etc. But are there any difficulty? They are not in power up to. Doesn't appear to be. So 82 bits, maybe the thought that the current floating point standards, as he was mentioning, they could be accommodated in 82 bits. Maybe, I don't know. Right? Okay, let's proceed with memory hierarchy design. And we said that so far we looked at the processors, the technologies that have gone into making the modern processors. But unless the memory hierarchy is able to supply instructions and data at the speed of the processors, then our computer will not benefit at all by using a fast processor. So let's see how has that issue been handled to be able to supply instructions and data at the speed of the processors. So this class will just look at some very basic aspects of the memory system. Even a very sophisticated processor like the ones that we discussed would perform well below a very ordinary processor, non-pipelined or whatever, unless we are able to have a matching performance by the memory system. It's able to supply instructions and data at the rate at which the processor is proceeding. Unless we are able to do that, the processor will just wait. It will spend most of its time waiting for instructions and data to arrive from the memory. So we will see today how memory system performance has been enhanced through various innovations and optimizations. So just to look at the typical memory hierarchy, we have main memory, secondary memory, L3 cache, L2 cache, L1 cache, processors and registers. Actually, the modern processors that we discussed, many didn't have L3 cache, some had L3 cache. So here we will initially focus on the cache, the L1, LT and L2 and L3 caches, and later we look at the main memory and virtual memory, what kind of improvements have been achieved there to meet the speed requirements of the processor. But as we know already that a fast cache is a fast storage used to improve the average access time of the slow main memory. And cache was possibly the earliest thing that was done to improve a memory system performance. And we know already that they exploit spatial temporal locality, etc. But let's look at how the processor memory gap has been tried to or attempted to bridged through caches. Just to look at it, let's look at the Alpha 21164, the strong ARM processor, the Pentium Pro, the area devoted to caches and so on, 37%, 61% and 64%, just look at that. And the percentage of transistors is much higher. The percentage of transistors devoted to the caches is much higher compared to the processors of other processing functions, the functional units and so on, the number of transistors is much lower for those compared to a cache. So just see the importance of the cache. But why is it that even though there is a 64% area, 88% of the transistors? How is that? See, everywhere, see, the percentage of transistors is much higher than the percentage of area for the caches. What may be the reason? Anybody knows? Yeah. The reason is that he has given the answer. He says that, see, the memory has a very uniform structure. The transistors are arranged in a very uniform way. As a result, large number of transistors could be integrated in a smaller area compared to the other transistors used for control, functional units and so on. So we can also have examples where we have two dies per a processor package. Externally you see there is one, but there is a processor containing the instruction cache and data cache, and there is a separate L2 cache on different dies, even though you see that it is one processor unit, but there are two dies inside it. But again, to think of it, even though we have spent so much of percentage of transistors and percentage of area on the silicon for a processor, etc., but just to think of it, caches have actually no inherent value. Their only role is to try to bridge the performance of the processors with the slow main memory. If the main memory was fast enough for the processors, then we won't need all this. So let's look at some very basic questions which some of you might already know. Actually, most of you would know. Where can a block be placed in a cache, called as the block placement problem? And we know the three options: fully associative cache, set associative cache, and the direct mapped cache. How can a block be identified from the cache, called as the block identification problem? You know, by indexing, then matching the tag, the block can be identified. Which block should be replaced on a miss? That's another basic question. We will not really discuss the details of this, because these we expect that you know already. If you don't know, please look. Called as the block replacement policy. So there can be a random policy, least recently used, and so on. What happens on a write? Called as the write strategy. So either it can be a write back or a write throw with a write buffer. So let's see, I think only a few issues we are discussing here. The rest will leave you, those who don't know those, not aware of those issues, please read up, because these are in our subsequent lectures, we will just use them without really trying to explain. So please read them. So if a block has only one possible place in the cache, each time it is brought into the cache, it can only occupy one unique place, then it is a direct mapped. And if it can be placed anywhere each time it is brought to the cache, it is a fully associative cache. And if a block doesn't have a unique place, but still it has only a restricted set of places, then it is set associative. And if there are n blocks in each subset, then it is a n way set associative. So to think of it, a direct mapped is actually one way set associative, right? A n way set associative cache becomes more difficult to implement for larger values of n. And most caches today are either one-way, two-way, or four-way set associative. There are only few examples that are eight-way set associative, but 16-way set associative and things like that, commercially, they are not popular.
Sir, why it is difficult?
Okay, we will just look at what is involved. As we proceed, we will see the control that is required. The control unit will see the delay that will cause. See, the question is interesting actually. He says that why is it that we can't have a 16-way set associative? So I was trying to tell him that see, if we do a 16-way set associative, then finding it, the control that will be needed to find the entry would become difficult. And as a result, the cache access time will increase. We'll see exactly how much it increases, how many cycles and so on, as because of even a 2-way or a 4-way set associative, the kind of delay they would increase and the kind of things that the modern memory hierarchy does to predict the last time which entry was accessed in the set and so on. We'll see that a 16-way set associative would become unacceptable in terms of the access time. Yeah, fully associative will be very unusable for large cache size that we are talking of. See, if it is a very small cache like a buffer, like let's say we'll in our discussions we'll look at today's, not today's, maybe in the next class discussion, we'll see that there are many buffers that are used, small buffers, 8 entry, 4 entry and so on. Those are fully associative, because there the complexity can be managed. But here for large cache that we are talking of, the kind of delay that would be incurred would become unacceptable. We'll see the elements of delay, what is involved in really locating an element in a set associative cache and so on. We'll look at details and we'll analyze the delay and we'll see what is being done to reduce the delay. But whatever being done now, they are hardly able to handle the 4-way, 8-way associative. 8-way is of course very difficult. 16-way associative is almost practically impossible. We'll see that. The kind of delay that will cause will make it comparable to a very slow memory. We'll look at that. But larger n, as he was trying to say, that is it that we don't have any place for a fully associative cache? Not, we are not saying that. See, fully associative cache has its place in the term of buffers and so on, where we have only few entries to look for, right? So the larger the n, the lower the likelihood of thrashing. Thrashing is basically two entries we need simultaneously, but they are trying to map into the same location or something, into the same set, right? So there would be a thrashing. You just get one entry, by the time you get the other entry you will have to fetch it again and so on. So in problems like this we will use a fully associative cache for small buffers, but for the cache that we are talking of, the L1, L2 cache, L3 cache, we will use for L1 cache maybe 2-way set associative, for L2 cache maybe 4-way set associative. But we looked at Pentium, said 8-way set associative for the L2 cache. L1 of course is a fast cache, right? L1 has to have a faster access time compared to L2, isn't it? So L1 cannot be even 4-way associative. L1 has to be 2-way associative. We'll look at those things. So if two blocks compete for the same frame and they're accessed one by one in sequence over and over, we will be incurring unnecessary fetching of the element from a lower memory. So that is thrashing. Each time you need it, it is not there. So a larger value of n would lower the likelihood of a thrashing. But still, due to the difficulties that we mentioned, we will not really use anything beyond 8-way associative. So let's look at the block identification problem. So given an address, how do we find where it is placed in the cache? So because this is a very important thing, we'll be almost every now and then we'll be referring to it. I'm just recapturing what you should know from a first level course. So we have a tag field, an index field, and an offset. The offset of the address in the cache block contains one full block. The address for all the block elements in the block is contained in the block offset. Then there is an index, then there is a tag field. So we first index into the cache by using these addresses. Depending on the size of the cache, the index number of bits in the index would vary, right? So if you had a 1024 entry cache, we would need a 10 bit index. Do you agree with that? Anyone who doesn't agree? If we have a 1024 entry cache, we would need a 10 bit index. Number of sets basically. The number, we never said anything about directly mapped or full set associative. We are talking of a set associative cache here. So if there are 1024 entries in the cache, a set associative or a direct, whatever it is, doesn't matter. We will need 10 entries in the index. So using this, we will index into the cache, and then we will check whether the entry is present or not by comparing the tag. But just to check whether you had an understanding in the first level course, can we have the highest order bits as the index and the middle order bits as the tag? See, lower order bits are the offset, isn't it? These identify the consecutive elements in the block. But can we have the upper fields as tag and the middle fields as the upper fields as the index and the middle fields as the tag? Anyone saying yes? But how come I don't see very confident? See, some faces are confident. But the other faces are just thinking about it. So these are some questions in the first level course. Okay. Now let's consider an example, because we said that this aspect of the very basic aspect of the cache is really crucial to our subsequent discussion. We'll use it every now and then. Just let's look at an example. So let's consider 64-bit addresses, byte addressable memory. Frame size is 64 bytes, and the cache size is 64 megabytes, and it consists of 2 to the power 20 block frames, right? Because the block size is 64 bytes, therefore the number of block frames is 2 to the power 20. Looks familiar to all of you? Somebody is finding these things unfamiliar? Those who are finding it unfamiliar, please brush up your knowledge in the first level architecture course. Direct mapped, for each cache block brought in the memory, there is a single possible frame among the 2 to the power 20 available. But let's look at so it will look like this. A 64 address could be decomposed as 6-bit block offset because of the 64 bytes, 20-bit set index because of the cache size of 64 megabytes, and then there is a 38-bit tag. So this is the 2 to the power 20 entries that we are talking of. The set of 20 bits, they determine the position that address would occupy in the cache. All addresses with similar 20 set index will compete for a single block frame, right? We are just talking of a direct mapped cache, so all of them will compete for a single block frame. So given address from the CPU, I think there is a, we should take the index part here. I think there is a, we should have painted this one here, and then we should check with the index and then check the set there. I think this is what shows. So we find the set first by using the index bits, right? and then we compare the tag to see actually it is there or some other entry is present. And then we take the required byte that is required, that is present here. Out of the 64 bytes present here, we just load or store the respective byte. In a write through cache, the information is written to both the cache and the memory. The block is written to the cache and the memory. Whereas in a write back, the information is written back to the memory only when the block is replaced. So the lower caches are not updated. Even when the cache is written, it is written to the lower cache only when it is replaced. So it uses a dirty bit. Just to recapture what you know from my first course, to indicate whether a block was actually written to. And advantage of the write back is that it saves unnecessary writes to the memory when the block is clean. The trade-offs between the write back and the write through: in a write back, it would be faster writes, isn't it? Because this would occur at the speed of the cache, not at the speed of memory. Whereas if it is a write through, it would operate, writing would operate at the speed of memory, unless we do something very intelligent. So write back would be faster. It is faster because multiple writes to the same block is written back to the memory only once, and also it uses less memory bandwidth. See, not only that we just write here and then proceed, but also the number of accesses to the memory is reduced, and as a result it saves us memory bandwidth. But what about the write allocate and no write allocate? When there is a write miss, so trying to write entry and find that it is not there in the cache, for a read miss, of course you will have to get it. But for a write miss, would you just get it or just write it? Because anyway you have updated the entry. There are two options for write miss. One is write allocate. You actually get the block, allocate it. The other is no write allocate, no block allocation. Just write it to them, just reflect it in the main memory. In no write allocate, only blocks that are read from the cache can be in the cache. So if you don't write allocate, each subsequent write to the same location would take the same amount of time as writing to memory. But typically we'll see that write allocate is used with a write back policy and no write allocate used with write through. So just think about it, why it makes sense. A write allocate would be used with write back and a no write allocate with write through. See, this we are talking of the, we're just reviewing the first level basic things. So just think about it. Those who don't see the answer here, just think about it. Now let's start our discussion. We had seen some very basic aspects, the cache and so on. We said that those who are not really feeling very familiar with that, please read up the first level books. And we will make an assumption that all of you understand those things, and based on that the subsequent discussions are built up. So when we talk of a memory system performance and how to improve it, we'll talk of few terms very frequently. One is latency, the other is bandwidth of the memory, the other is average memory access time, or AMAT. The latency is the time when you request something from the memory and the time the data, at least the first byte of the data, is available. The latency is the time once the request is issued, the first byte of data to be supplied, that's the latency of the memory. Whereas bandwidth, once the data starts coming, at what rate it is coming, right? The average memory access time is the time it takes the processor to get a data item it requests. So both latency and bandwidth determine the average memory access time. So sometimes you might get the data very fast, sometimes you might get it much later. Do you agree with that? Why is that? Why is it sometime you will get it very fast, sometime you will get? Yes. So sometimes it might be present in the cache, you get it immediately. Otherwise it may not be in the cache, it has to be fetched from the lower memory. So we are averaging out. The average time the processor would wait for data, it will stall its operations. We are talking of a very simple processor. Let's keep initially a very simple processor in mind which stalls for a data. We had seen that modern processors don't stall for data. They continue executing other instructions. And also they execute many instructions at the same time and so on. So the stall thing that we are talking of here, the average cycles a processor waits for a data to arrive, stalling all its operation, that please keep in mind when we use those terms, please keep in mind a very simple processor which suspends all its activities, just waits for the data to arrive before it can proceed further. So an average memory access time is the same as the processor stall time for very simple processors. And the time varies, as you all answered, that due to the memory hierarchy, the access time can vary from one data to other, and we are talking of the average time of that. In another way to look at it is that the average memory access time is the cache hit time plus miss rate into miss penalty. So if it is available in the cache, we directly get it, which is the cache hit time. If it is not present, that is the rate at which, or the percentage of the miss rate, if let us say 90% are available here, so 90% the cache hit time, if we first write to the L1 cache and then write to the, sorry, first if it is a miss, if we first get it to the cache and then we supply it, then this is cache hit time, otherwise we would have here 1 minus miss rate here. Do you see that point, what I am saying here? Miss rate into miss penalty. So cache hit time plus miss rate into miss penalty. The performance of a cache is largely determined by the miss rate, which is the number of cache misses divided by the number of accesses. The cache hit time, the time between sending address and the data is present and the data returning from the cache, that the hit time. And the miss penalty is the extra processor stall cycles caused by access to the next level cache. So we can write here the CPU performance with memory stall is the cycles per instruction without stall plus memory stall cycles per instruction. See, if there is no access to the memory, the CPI would be what if no data was accessed, right? So the CPU performance with memory stall, assuming that there are some data which we have to access from memory, then this will be CPI without stall plus memory stall cycles, because for some of the data it has to wait, so it will be the CPI without stall plus the memory stall cycles per instruction. This is the average memory stall cycles per instruction. But we had seen that the average memory stall cycles per instruction is the miss per instruction into miss penalty. Right? So the percentage of memory access, which is equal to the percentage of memory accesses per instruction, because one instruction might do multiple accesses. How can it do multiple accesses? Because one would be to fetch the instruction and the other would be if it is to do either a read or write. So there can be two accesses for some instructions. Most of the instruction will need one access for fetching, some will need two accesses. So percentage of memory accesses per instruction into the miss rate into miss penalty. So just look at an example. Assume that there is 20% memory access per instruction. Let's see here, 20% memory access per instruction, 2% miss rate, 400 cycle miss penalty. How much is the memory stall cycle per instruction? So we just substitute here, 2% is the miss rate, 20% memory access per instruction, and 400 cycle is 1.66 cycles. Right? Now, okay, let me just give you a problem, or maybe we just look at this. This we already had seen, that a CPU performance with memory stall is CPI without stall plus memory stall cycles, which is basically the instruction cycle into the cycles per instruction without stall and the cycle per instruction with stall into cycle time. The stall cycles here, the memory stall cycles. The cycle per instruction for memory stall is the miss per instruction, miss penalty, and the cycle per instruction with memory stall is memory instruction frequency into miss rate into miss penalty. Simple things we had seen earlier. So let me just give you a small problem, please do it. One program has 20% load store instructions. A program consists of 20% load store instructions. Cache hit time is 1 cycle. Cache miss penalty is 100 cycles. Miss rate, cache miss rate is, let's say, 1%. So what is the average memory stall cycles per instructions? Or I can just reword this question and ask you that compared to another program which had 30% load store instruction, what would be the difference in the memory stall cycles per instruction? You can just reword this, but let's do this first. So just think of for a minute, how do you do? Very simple. So I hope everybody is trying. Anyone has got the answer? Sorry? 12. No, 12 looks... 12 looks very, very odd here. 1.2. Okay, let's see how they did. So basically, 20% load store instruction. So the number of average number of memory access per instruction is 1.2, isn't it? That's the average memory accesses per instruction, and this is 1 plus 1.2 into 0.01 into 100, isn't it? So the average memory access time will be 2.2. Does that appear all right? The average memory access time will be 2.2, because is the average memory access per instruction, 1 to fetch, and 20% are load store. So on the average, if you look at 1.2 memory access per instruction, and the miss rate is 1% for this 1.2, and there is a 100 cycle penalty. So you will get 2.2 cycles is the average memory access time. Does that appear okay? Does that appear all right? Okay. So average memory access time rather than stall times, right? Okay. So because this one cycle, it doesn't really stall. So that's what he is saying. Okay. So let me just rephrase this. Average memory access time. So the average memory access time, typically it takes one cycle. Cache hit time is one cycle. And the miss rate is 1% and miss penalty is 100 cycle. And it is the access time is 2.2 cycle. And we are saying that, see this one cycle it takes, we don't really consider it as stalling the processor, because the hit, let's not consider it as stalled the procedure, the processor. But if we consider this as stalling the processor, one cycle it is stalled, even if there is a hit, then we will say 2.2 cycles is the average stall cycles per instruction, right? So let's be careful about that. So if we say that whenever there is a memory access, even if there is a cache hit, the processor stalls for one cycle, then this is 2.2 cycles. But if we say that if there is a hit, there is no stall, the cycle time of this is same as the processor cycle time, and it has issued, and there is a separate cycle for waiting for the result to arrive, so depends on the pipeline, then it would be 1.2. Does that appear okay? No, this somebody answered. I had written down somebody answered. Yeah. See, the average number of memory accesses per instruction, one memory access will be there to fetch the instruction, and 20% load store. One will be for fetching the instruction, and 0.2 is for those load store instruction which need to do a data access. So on the average, 1.2 times memory would be accessed per instruction. Does that appear all right? Now let's look at another example. Clock rate is 200 megahertz. or 5 nanosecond per cycle, the ideal number of misses, the ideal with no misses is 1.1. The cycle per instruction is 1.1. The clock rate is 200 megahertz, or there is a 5 nanosecond per cycle clock rate. There are 50% arithmetic logic, 30% load store, and 20% control instruction. 10% of data memory operations get 50 cycle miss penalty. 1% of instruction memory operation also get 50 cycle miss penalty. So we're talking of two similar cases here, for data and the instruction, they incur same penalty. The data memory operations get 50 cycle penalty, also the instruction accesses get 50 cycle miss penalty. But because the instruction caches, we'll see in subsequently that always the instruction caches will have a lower miss rate. 1% miss rate for the instruction cache, 10% miss rate for data cache. What may be the reason? Why is it that such a higher miss rate for a data cache, whereas a much smaller miss rate for instruction cache? Yeah, the locality is very high for instructions. Normally they are accessed in sequence, whereas data can be random. So there is always a higher, in all the examples we will be doing for next several classes, we will see that the data cache will have a much higher miss rate compared to the instruction cache. And as a result, we will see that some processors use a smaller instruction cache compared to a data cache. Okay, whatever, those we will look at later. So please try to do this problem. So miss rate for just a simple extension of what we had done here. So we're just saying that there are different miss rates for data accesses and different miss rates for instruction accesses, but the miss penalty is the same. And then we had said that how many load store are there, how many arithmetic control, and so on. Simple problem, just a small extension of what we did. Please try it. But as I can see that we are also running out of time. Some of you have classes immediately after this. Is that right? Okay. So please try it and we will discuss the solution in the next class. We will stop here.